I have prepared a presentation. I hope it's interesting to you. Otherwise, please go ahead and ask any questions. No. Give me some feedback if not. So the research is we're doing in LAI. It's not my own research, but also for my colleagues. And the aim of the presentation is, like Olaf said, to show you what we're doing at LAI and to see if we can cooperate together, because I think we have a lot in common. The agenda for the presentation, I'm going to give you a short introduction of what we're doing at LAI. And then I have two subjects that I maybe want to discuss. Two parts of the supply chain, the upstream, the smallholder farmers, and then more downstream, the consumers. I think those issues are also what you're working on. So I hope that I got that right and that is interesting. So LAI, we are located in the Netherlands. In The Hague, mainly, is our main office at sea, bordering the North Sea. And the research topics, when we were working previously a lot on agriculture policy, recently we started to move also on more food policy, so a lot broader than only farming, also supply chains, how can we create markets. Bio-based economy, of course, what's climate change, personalized nutrition for consumers, health, diets, and natural resources, fisheries, forestry. And we are mainly social scientists. I myself am an anthropologist, and we work a lot with econometrists. But also we have psychologists who work maybe on, for example, consumer behavior. So as I said, the value chain, we cover all the value chain, but today I want to focus on smaller farmers and downstream the consumers. Smaller farmers' livelihoods. As you know, smaller farmers are very important. There are more than 500 million smallholder farmers with an average of 2 hectares. I heard in Mexico it's like 50% of the farmers are smallholder farmers, is that correct? Yeah, more or less. And lots of people depend on it for their livelihoods, for their families, for their well-being. And these smallholder farmers are very important because they produce about 80% of the food consumed in Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa. And they are getting more important because we are going to be able to need to feed a lot of people by 2050, and we can only do that one of the ways is to intensify the production that we have. So these small farmers are very important. But it's not easy to intensify production. These small farmers have lots of challenges. They have mainly traditional cultivation methods that they have been doing already for hundreds of years. Well adjusted to the environment, to their livelihood. They have limited access to markets, they have limited power also in the supply chain. They're largely unorganized, very scattered. The land holding is usually informal, they don't have really, it's not theirs, they are allowed to use it. of course, they're very vulnerable also to climate change. They are drought, they have lots of issues to deal with. But of course, we can help them to improve and to intensify production, improve their livelihoods. We can help them taking out processing activities. Processing of mice, for example. What also is very necessary is that the cost of supply chain improvements are equally spread and don't only go, are only placed at the smaller farmers. We need to help them have more power together. There are also lots of export barriers. If you have beans, for example, coffee beans, if you process them in here, then you have export barriers. So, of course, the companies like Sarali, they want the green beans, they don't want processed. But yeah, then you lose as a farmer the value that you have in the your product to gain more money. Oh, sorry. Another thing, of course, is that that they have limited activities, it's just circle, they have limited, not so much crops, not so much money, inputs and services, so they're this vicious circle that they cannot invest. So, they cannot really increase their livelihoods. We need to help them with that. And training is one of the things that really can help the livelihoods and the activity to smallholder farmers. I believe that in CIMMYT also there's something that you do, right? Capacity building to help organize smallholder farmers. So, to conclude, we really need the smallholder farmers. We need them to increase production. We need them to help the climate, like deforestation issues, erosion. They can all help us with that, water quality. We need to help them. It's not that they are, they need some power, they need some help to do that. So, how is Leiwageningen contributing to that? We have, I only highlight three of the projects that we do. We do yield gap analysis, we have a sustainability consortium, and impact assessments on social standards. The yield gap analysis is our calculations about what is really what is the potential of the yields that you can produce. I heard, for example, from Gideon that in the mice farmers they produce 1 ton per hectare, but the potential is 6. So how can you? So that's kind of analysis also that we do with life. Is that correct?
What is the MWR on the axis?
Oh, that is a very good
Region and crop, so maize, wheat, and rice.
Yeah. It's mainly about rice. So, but it's all nice that we can calculate it, but actually, how are we able to close this yield gap? That's a far more difficult question, of course. You can do that with hybrid seeds. They're more drought and pest tolerant. But they can also have disadvantages for farmers. If they are getting too dependent on the seeds, they need to buy them every year, the costs are higher. That's also, of course, a difficult challenge for smaller farmers. Another thing to they can increase the use of fertilizer. With this access to markets, for example, when they are certified, can have more market power. And of course, you want them to increase their income. And as I said, training is a very good way to do that, but also help them with processing activities, so to add more value. And then another project is the Sustainability Consortium. This is an international consortium of universities. Wageningen is part of it. And we do a lot of work for Walmart, Kroger, Ahold. And we help them assessing their supply chain on environmental sustainability and social sustainability. So So we help them to make their supply chain more sustainable. And we also tell them, yes, these small apartments are very important. We need to help them and not only take from them, but also give them and help them to increase their production, to increase their livelihoods, increase their water quality, and issues like child labor, forced labor, also very important. So we do that in that consortium, and we make performance, key performance indicators, and they assess their suppliers, their suppliers, departments, to see how are they scoring on sustainability. And then they can help, they can support the suppliers more sustainable, they can compare with the suppliers, which one is performing better, and then they're saying, hey, yeah, your neighbor is performing much better than you, how is the deal, can we help you to also, they start working on that. So that's what we're also part of the slide. Another project that we do is impact assessments on standards. Have you heard of fair trade, Rainforest Alliance, are these standards, can you buy those products also in Mexico or in the US and Europe, the demand is increasing for that. And the idea behind is that with those standards you can improve the livelihoods of small farmers. Because they get a premium price or get some training. But is that really the case? That's the question. Are they really improving livelihoods? So my colleagues have done lots of these impact assessments on coffee, tea, cocoa, commodities. Not yet on mice and wheat, but I'm expecting that this is going to come also for mice and wheat, to this kind of certification. So we have done those a lot, and what comes out of it is that the main benefit is access to training. But of course, farmers need to pay for the certification. And then the only thing they're getting is training. The production is not really increasing. They have a little bit more access to credit, to finance, but it's very limited. So where is this? And then in the end they also don't get a lot of premium price for their products, because Walmart is paying the consumers, now they don't want to pay for this more expensive sustainable product. So this costs the farmer a lot of money and they don't get a lot out of it. So as a conclusion on the standards, the is very limited, the advantage, and it's mainly targeting the larger farmers because they have the mass, they have the organization, and they can pay the money for the standards because they get a little bit of premium. But other farmers that you want to look like you, the smaller farmers, they are not benefiting. Another issue is that the demand, there is more supply than demand at the moment. So there are also products that are certified, sustainable, but they are not sold as certified. So of course the premium is also gone. The training, that's something that helps a little bit, but there are also lots of governmentalized training that is farmers. So going from now to the other end of the supply chain to the consumers. What are the global issues with consumers? This year is the first year that there are more obese people than underweight people in the world. So that's becoming a really big problem. You were just talking about Mexico is also a little bit of an issue with that, but the States and also later we will see Egypt. So that's a really Here you can see, for example, the combination between children that are, that we call the double burden, children that are poor, they don't have, yeah, they're under nutrition. And then
Y-axis.
The obesity in women older than, yeah, so when they're adults. And you see, for example, Egypt, that, yeah, so the children are poor, they have nutrition, but later, when they're adult, they are becoming obese. How did that to do with all kinds of issues, like status, eating products that are cheap, but not good for your health? So this is what we call the double burden burger. Yeah, and why is this all is happening? Because we're eating more processed food. And the Unilevers in this world are money with this processed food. But yeah, it's not so healthy. You see that that has really increased the amount of processed food that we're eating at the expense of meats and dairy products. And the other graph is saying that, yeah, we are eating more snacks. Yeah, we are, instead of eating a nice meal or whale on salsa verde from the toilets, we eat some snacks that they are not good for us, opposed to Dutch club size brokers, but it's pastry, all those things. The main issue is that we need enough food, we need enough nutrients, but not moderation, right? It's very important. I was talking to Gideon about it. Plates have become bigger and bigger. We need to get them smaller again. And yeah, of course, for many people, it's also still having the right foods and nutrients, right? Like protein, vegetables, fruits. So how is live agriculture contributing to this problem? To products that we are doing, the nutrition gap analysis and food systems for healthy diets. First, the nutrition gap analysis. This is a very interesting relation between the farmers, what they produce. And when you have larger farms with more diverse crops, you see that they also eating in a more healthy way. They eat more diverse products, they spend more money on food, and they have better calorie intake. So that's a very interesting relationship. I'm not sure how we are going to solve it, because I also understood that high microbes only need more, and then we will have less diverse products. But there is this balance there. It's difficult. So the other product is the CGRCD product that LIGHT has a very important part in. And hopefully we can cooperate on this flagship with you as well. It's a very long, very long project, and it's about, healthier diets. How do we get these healthier diets? And all the issues that play a role in supply chain, legislation, economic aspects, technical aspects. So all these issues are dealt with in this project. And we have divided in the supply side and the demand side. On supply chains, several questions play a role. So have producers, resources, or different way, but not eat so much of this processed food and sugar and all the things that we don't really need. But are they willing to do that, and under which conditions? Farmers, are they willing to invest in new crops? Under what conditions as well? And gender, of course, is very important issue. Women have a lot of decision power on the crops, but also what you buy. Very important. And there is lots of information, but is this information really coming across? People understand it. And also, is it easy? I mean, you know very well, I mean, when you go to the supermarket, the first thing that is lying on eye level or on the counter are the things that you don't want to eat too much. The products that are really healthy, you need to look for them on somewhere on the top or on the bottom. So these are issues that we're also looking at. How can you give people incentives to eat it's more healthy stuff? Can you put it on eye level? Can you put it on track? Can you put it in the counter? Our supermarket now, we have this, when the children enter, we have this small basket. The children can pick their fruit in the store. I think it's a very good initiative. But yeah, there are all sorts of ways, we call it nudging, to stimulate people to eat healthy. And that's what we do when we do this project, and also pricing legislation. Can we put a tax on fat or sugar? How is that working out? Another issue, of course, is also the waste loss in the supply chain. Consumers are throwing away a lot of food, 50%. We have also post-harvest losses that we can do something about. So lots of work to be done the coming 5 years. And I really hope we can work with you also on this. And so this presentation was not only made by me, I got a lot of input from my colleagues who are working as well on these issues. And I want to thank you, and let's see if you have any remarks or questions. I'll be here for the next hour or two. We are on holiday now in Mexico. My husband and my family lives in Pachuca. So please, if you have any suggestions, you can email me. My email is my contact person. So let me see, are there any
How do you see the existence of small-scale farmers on the long run? Because I'm having my doubts about this. We keep pretending that they will be around forever, but if you look at Europe, US, Asia, in many places they have disappeared. I see some niches like, let's say, organic farming or vegetable farming with good market access. Seems to be working elsewhere.
Yes, it's working.
I mean, I wouldn't like to be a small-scale farmer in the developing world anywhere. It's not a nice job. The young people don't want to do it anymore, and in many places it doesn't make sense anymore. So I would like to hear.
That's true. Yes. Yeah, of course. But it's also because of all the things that I said. It's really limited power, limited organization. In some parts of the world, it's just a farm. They really need some.
actually, when we see, I understand the question of Kyle, because we try to work with small scale farming systems, and we say let's diversify their systems for improving their diets.
That is a twisted thing, because this dual burden of malnutrition is mainly within the suburban, urban, poor urban,
yeah.
Let's say.
Yeah.
So that's a strange way to analyze attacking the small scale rural to tackle a problem on the urban poor. But then in Europe and US, what we see now is that the trend is towards small scale farming for the healthy diet and the healthy products.
Yeah.
So actually the small scale farmer market and all that are coming from actually small scale farming.
Yeah.
So what's the role now in Europe?
Yeah, so as you say, organic products is really increasing in the Netherlands. But also we see that there are more and more people want local food. So and also with urban farming, on rooftops people are having their own garden. So that's increasingly people want to be closer to. They want to go to the farm.
Because they're better off actually specializing in fewer crops that will allow them to have a more of a market entry. So I just wonder how robust this finding is and whether you do have some good papers that you can point us to.
Yeah, and then I need to direct it to my colleagues. But this is mainly also about larger farms, the relation. I guess on very small farms,
suggested you were talking of Africa or developing countries.
Yes, I am.
And then others, it sounded more like Netherlands or Europe or developed. And
yeah.
It was a little bit hard sometimes to keep those separate, at least for me.
Yeah, the farms and then all the impact assessment is only in developing countries, yes. Sometimes I give an example for consumers because, I know how that's going for something in the Netherlands, but that's not. That's my own bias. So the analysis, this is only in developing countries.
Yeah. So this is in developing countries, right?
Yes.
And Africa, Asia, or a mix, or.
Maybe it's better to go here. This one you mean? The green is the good impacts, yeah.
So it's last, when we sent down, so the 19 and river.
You have to look in the mirror, actually.
Yeah.
Then you look in the mirror and you see the right graph.
Yeah.
I think this is very important.
You put it up instead of what it is? I mean, change the axis? The axis?
No, it's just looking there,
just
let the axis.
Just look to 0 and 100.
An organizational level, they can see, right?
But the key is basically access to training is the most successful one.
Yeah.
But it's very discouraging.
Okay.
To see that access to inputs doesn't change.
No.
So, and basically this is standards for farmers that are delivering to big companies.
Yes, yes,
so
I know.
Really,
it's really, this is really astonishing.
If I understood well, the training is about the standards.
Yeah.
Yeah, so the standards give training to farmers.
About the standards.
And how does that help?
So the training, they get the training, but they don't get a little bit access to the credit, no access to inputs there, a little bit better access to markets.
But some farmers do, the larger ones do.
What?
Yeah, the larger
farmers
yeah.
do, but not the small farmers.
No, but it's meant also to have the small farmers, but it's the impact.
But what does Unilever say? Because Unilever has the CEO of Unilever is a big story. He gets an award because he is for demand of sustainability, right?
Yeah.
And working with smallholder farmers worldwide, sourcing, sustainable sourcing, how do you call that, responsible sourcing.
Yeah.
So what does he say when he sees this?
Yeah, so...
Would it be an idea just to visit him?
We have in the sustainability consortium, I tell them also this, because they want to develop these KPIs that are so when you have like fair trade, then you comply with this KPI, like gender or forced labor. But I also tell them yes, but we have like same practices.
This is a big story, like over 100,000 farmers. Or
yes,
thousands. Everybody is using Walmart is in there. Retailers are in there, just go there and say, hey, this is what he finds.
It's a complicated story. They say, I'm telling it now very simple, but they're saying, there are some in-kind benefits, but how is this helping the living income? It's not really.
But did you publish this?
This is published, yes.
This is
potentially
a big
story. I think so too, yes. I keep telling it, but
it doesn't
come through yet.
And the next thing is, do you guys have solutions? Because this is showing it's not good enough, right?
No, it's not.
So, does your team have suggestions how to improve? And because that's what the big organization would like to do.
Yes, that's exactly what we are going to work. Also, our take is also to do with sustainability consortium with private. And I tell them, yes, I would want to do it. But they're saying, of course, farms is very difficult, we cannot go to the farms, the trainers, they need to go to the farms. For us, we are certified, so that's it. We're doing our best, standards don't work, what's our problem?
This was done for a portfolio of companies?
No, this was
this
done
is
for
one specific company
fair trade or for OOPS? For the standards?
Standards.
Yeah.
Because basically, indeed, what you're saying here is, it's not worth your while. It's just window dressing, and you might as well forget about it.
There's a lot of greenwashing.
But was there any positive thing that you could indicate? Because, access to training.
They say, okay.
Did he's one of the
co-authors.
6 years ago on the effect of certification in cotton.
Yeah.
And the conclusion that he drew from that is, again, part on training and education that was there, but the ones who actually benefited most net were the farmers who did not participate, but lived in the vicinity of those, because the farmers who did participate had all the costs, all the transaction costs. The fact that they had to make all kinds of costs, but weren't being able to recuperate their costs, whereas the farmers who lived in the vicinity were doing it just the regular way, benefited from the spin-offs of the education and the provision of some of the, in some cases, level and not for the public. So it made a lot of sense to be the neighbor of somebody who was participating in the certification scheme.
It made a lot of sense to be a free rider.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Oh, and also we decided to be in Ivory Coast and Ghana. And then we always have a control group for people that are not certified and then the certified. But then in the end, the uncertified were. They were doing better because there was also a governmental program focusing on smallholders and training. And in the end, those farmers were performing better. The control group was performing better than the standard. Yeah.
And maybe at one point, the answer is my specific on the collaboration. Now, our level, we have. Like our similar in my want to collaborate, but you know, at the scientist level, that's where it has to happen, right?
Yeah.
Now, can you show that slide? Because there's a lot of developments in relation to the CRPs and the contribution of the Netherlands. Food and nutrition is a very important one. They are going to do it through WOTO. So it really comes down that scientists find each other and basically say, okay, we would like to write a joint project. Now, where do you see opportunity? Because I see something in food processing, like with Vincenzo. But also in the whole nutrition area. So could maybe people that are interested have contact with you to see how can we get in there? Because IFPRI is leading the nutrition program. But you know, there's some people think that wheat and maize, there's nothing in there, but there is a lot of stuff in there. And also we have Urban Harvest Plus, the QVM maize, all these kind of things. So
yes.
We are in Ethiopia, Bangladesh, Kenya, India, Ghana
Colombia.
Through IIT,
Colombia.
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 No, we are working with Isaac Mason in Colombia.
But how can you have an idea how it's organized in America? So is there a team working together in the leadership of Ruud?
Yeah, under leadership of Ruud, yes. So, yeah.
So this is a specific defined project, food systems for healthy diets.
Yeah.
It's one of the flagships
So within A4NH, Wageningen is leading this specific flagship.
Yeah, and
so it's one of the flagships within A4NH. It's kind of a new setup in the new setup of the second phase. And so there is an interest to see how we can link up together some of the agro food system CRPs with this cross-cutting food. food systems. So.
And who's the flagship leader called Inge Brouwer?
Inge Brouwer.
Yeah.
Well, on that one with the collaboration, I've always, I mean, many times when we talk about the aspects around, for example, nutrition aspects, my experience has been that it's a bit of a dead end for us in the sense because everything we have, let's say, an accepted mandate in, as it's set up with the Harvest Plus and the CP and so on the high end breeding aspects. But anything that comes to understanding actually how do things work in the larger setting, supply or input output chains, etc., and so on, we always, I think, get the message that, well, that's Harvest Plus, and we cannot do anything there because either we step on acorinations and increase toes, or we step on the Harvest Plus toes. So that just makes it very difficult sometimes. I can see the tops of things.
Well, why back up, we have a project bilateral.
I don't quite understand why.
To acreage.
I don't quite understand why.
Natalia wants to elaborate.
Yeah, I mean, that could be the one case.
Yeah.
But we also have a few projects where we are actually more working with the
past we have mainly collaborated on the Harvest Plus front, and
yeah.
Harvest Plus
yeah.
is a subset of A4H.
Yeah.
The A4H agenda is really increasing a lot, yeah, including this new flagship. So Inge Brouwer, she's a nutritionist in Wageningen, she's co-leading this with Ruud Ruben, who was listed, who's more from the social science as head of the lay, and then also Marit van den Berg, who's on development economics in Wageningen. But it's mainly Inge and Ruud who are co-leading this,
yeah.
and it's really exploring and expanding the agenda beyond, way beyond Harvest Plus and way beyond what A4H has kind of done in the past. And so they're also looking into ways, how can they collaborate? I mean, it's a new flagship, we're still exploring and testing the waters how we're going to make this work, but I mean, there's a definite interest from our side in terms of the agro-food system, CRPs. We haven't done that much on nutritional aspects.
Mm-hmm.
We have a small flagship where indeed we're looking into some aspects, including nutritional enhancement, as well as processing, as well as post-harvest. But how can we link up to some of the bigger initiatives and potentially funding sources? As Martin knows, the Nature Challenge are funding through A4H, not to base or directly. So only if we don't tackle the Nature Challenge, it would be through such collaboration as this, that finding space for the
Let's see.
I don't think there is space, it's now finding that.
Olaf, you're in contact person now with Ruud for us, Synod?
Yeah, we have been in touch on this. And I mean, the CRP has been developed. It's as you know, a painful process, but we're getting there.
Also, in the FP4, CRP maize and wheat.
On the system.
At least we are starting to put metrics related to nutrition in terms of the sustainable intensification of farming systems. We are very inexperienced on that, but at least now it's on the paper, and now we should from next year for phase two. Not necessarily that we do the kind of work related to nutrition, but at least that's when we are thinking of.
some question in the back, or?
Yeah, well, I was just thinking about how, you know, it seems like putting consumers and small-scale farmers together, you have a lot of times diverging interests in that, especially with urbanization and more women working, you know, looking for convenience foods. You see that in sub-Saharan Africa and other places. It's happening a lot. And so that's, it's a complex thing to try to reconcile.
Did you mention that you worked on the post-harvest aspects as well?
Yes, we do.
Yeah.
We personally mentioned this.
That's another aspect of Chamber.
Yeah.
Again, we have perhaps
post-harvest losses and also
aflatoxin
waste in consumers and in retail.
Yeah. I mean, that would be a direct you want into to the new flagship, as Natalia mentioned, with IITA, for example. Because they work on the AflaSafe and on the storage aspects. And we have
post-harvest losses are, I think, also here in this flagship.
But you know, you have to look also from the donor's perspective.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Netherlands has just said, it's also my initiative to be honest, that the funding should not just go to the CGIAR and let it go, but also to make sure that the funding is also used to link up directly with Wageningen. So that's happening now. Basically, so you can blame me. But the money is going to four programs, and this is AFRH is one of them. Maize and wheat are not in there.
Mm-hmm.
So if we want to link up with Netherlands, but funding, then we need to team up with Wageningen. You see that there's been the one and two money going to Wageningen now in a new setting, and we need to find a collaborative mechanism to projects within A4NH. So that's, and then we can link it later on with what we do in wheat and maize with all the donors. So I think we have to be pragmatic here, because with all the donors, it's that we win the one and two, or just get it or not. Here it's going to be a bottom collaboration scientist level, and then you can find your way into this program. But this program is now, like all the CRPs, accessible everywhere. So it was watching, so you can just evaluate and see if there is something interesting. But most important, I think, contact with the scientists around. That's the key. So if I can be useful for something that we need.
Okay.
Another question, otherwise we'd like to thank Benedict for making the time and the effort of pulling together different people's work for this presentation, standing in the crossfire here in terms of having to defend it. But thanks for making the effort of reaching out, for touching base, and giving us a flavor of some of the work. Yeah? So thank you very much.